I was recently in Antwerp, Belgium for IMEC's event ITF World 2024. IMEC is widely known as the semiconductor industry's watering hole, a neutral ground where all the animals on the savanna can get together to work on major problems. One reason why I attended the show, and I paid my own way there, was because I have never been to this part of Europe before, it would be fun visiting. Another is to learn about the state of leading-edge research in semiconductors and what people have been working on and thinking about. In this video, I want to share a bit of that, what I'm hearing, and reflection on the show in general. The show opened with a series of headlining presentations. 2024 marks 40 years since IMEC's founding in 1984, so I feel like they put particular effort into this one. I was at the gala dinner, where I met a few friends of the show, and the dinner was set in an impressive location, and we were treated to a very fun dance show. I wonder how much that cost. And for the information sessions, IMEC got some very prestigious people to come out to Belgium to present. It's a demonstration of IMEC's stature within the overall industry. There were these booths with teams demonstrating new technologies, and I only got a chance to talk to a few of them. Much of them seemed to involve medicine or biology, but the teams I did get to talk to were impressive. Alright, let's talk about some takeaways from the show. The great context of the show from people is that we are in a new era of scaling. During the 1980s and 1990s, the industry was spoiled by rich gains from lithography. It was easy to shrink the designs because we just switched to a new wavelength. This was so effective that it drowned out many other alternatives to scaling. But then, in the early 2000s, we got 193 nanometer lithography, and progress down the wavelength ladder massively slowed down to a turtle's crawl. Intel and others chased 157 nanometers for a while, but that never made it into high-volume production. But even as the industry was going through that, they knew in the back of their mind that there was another wavelength coming, EUV. And now EUV is here. It's been running for several years, and it is now a mature technology. But nobody is credibly talking about doing another wavelength in the future. Without the biggest arrow in the quiver, we need to find other ways to achieve scaling. Nothing will ever be as good as what we had back then, but as the song goes, you can't always get what you want, but if you try sometimes, you get what you need. Advanced packaging is a real thing. There are substantial products out there with it, and that is a major advancement. There are also substantial flaws that we need to review and engineer our way around. A traditional silicon die is on a single plane. It's all there for you to look at, inspect, and dissipate heat from. 2.5D integration, where you put things on top of a silicon interposer, keeps a lot of that. But 3D integration is where people want to go, and we are not ready, yet, to handle the heat and inspection problems associated with that. Multiple people I talked to mentioned this. I stumbled across a few companies trying to solve the problem, but it is early. For this reason, as well as the fact that heterogeneous integration adds substantial complexity, the industry largely holds that it can only be one tool, amidst a bunch of others, to help make better chips. It is not a panacea. The AI boom remains a thing. It is often mentioned as a significant demand driver for the industry. However, people here in Europe do not seem to be as, quote-unquote, scale-pilled as they are in the Silicon Valley. Whether it has to do with their focus on social issues or privacy, or because it is all happening far away from them, I can feel more pessimism from the people here. Setting that aside, however, it is also undeniable that machine learning will continue to revolutionize and open new avenues for semiconductor manufacturing. Machine learning is already responsible for turning optical proximity corrections from simple logical tick marks that we add to the design into what is essentially abstract art. That sort of work will continue to bleed in, though I doubt that any foundry will be using GPT-5 or something due to a general error of conservatism. Maybe it is because we are in Europe, but sustainability is a major discussion point here. There are two big themes within this space that caught my eye. First, because semiconductor manufacturing is so energy intensive, it is responsible for a great deal of carbon emissions. Fabs run 24/7, which means they have to draw a lot of power and from carbon intensive sources. For this reason, IMEC estimates that semiconductor manufacturing, meaning the work done after the wafer is created, is more carbon intensive than beef production or even flight travel. But those are just estimates. The key thing is that we do not have any information since semiconductor companies are so unwilling to share data. So IMEC is working on a cryptological platform that lets those guys confidentially share information that we can manipulate and compare without actually revealing it. Its applications are not necessarily carbon or semiconductor specific, but are nevertheless intriguing. Second, something more recently appearing in my field of view, the semiconductor industry has been paying more attention to quote-unquote forever chemicals, or PFAS. Companies like ASML are starting to drill down into their supply chain to learn about their exposure to these chemicals. This is not just a European thing. A great policy paper published by China Talk mentioned this as well, presenting it as a commercial opportunity for the U.S. CHIPS Act's new Semiconductor R&D Institute, the National Semiconductor Technology Center, or NSTC. By the way, I wish they had a different name for the NSTC. Between Taiwan's National Science and Technology Council, the U.S.'s NSIT, which is the National Institute of Standards and Technology, and NTSC, which is a video format standard, it is confusing. At least Semitech had SEM in the name. Anyway, with regards to semiconductors and the PFAS, or forever chemicals in particular, there are two major concerns. First has to do with photoresist, the very special chemicals that are exposed to ultraviolet light in order to transfer the wafer onto the pattern. These basically use PFAS in huge quantities and are absolutely fundamental to the semiconductor process. So for a long time, this was a major and seemingly insurmountable roadblock to PFAS elimination. However, there has been some recent new developments. The emergence of new EUV photoresists, like metal oxide resists, present the first possible alternatives to the old compounds. So there are some glimmers of hope there. But then we have the second point, the fact that these chemicals are extraordinarily prevalent. We use them in everything. There are many dozens of chemicals in this category. They're literally everywhere, and removing them means having to make difficult choices because there are so few alternatives. I think this topic deserves a more complete video down the line, and I hope to work on something like this later. The semiconductor industry is making these moves because they apparently feel like the government regulators might do something about this down the line, so organizations like the SIA are starting to collect information on this, perhaps to build a roadmap down the line. Former ASML president and CTO Martin Vandenbrink gave a short but very dense and informative speech about lithography. It will require a lot of processing, which has to be done later, but something I noticed is how he happened to slip hyper-NA EUV near the end. With high-NA EUV, the NA is 0.55. With hyper-NA EUV, the NA again rises to 0.75. Last year, Vandenbrink had been asked a few questions about the technology in an interview, saying, "Theoretically, it can be done. Technologically, it can be done. But how much room is left in the market for even larger lenses? Could we even sell those systems?" But here we are now at this presentation, and Vandenbrink is putting hyper-NA EUV on the roadmap to come out in 2032, about 8 or 9 years from now. Maybe it's just the final troll since he's retiring. I agree that it can be done. There's nothing stopping ASML from putting a hyper-NA EUV system out there. I really do worry, though, just how economically feasible it is to ratchet up the NA again and again. But, and this is something I've been hearing many times during this trip, the other options are not that great. There is no other option for optical lithography, and 13.5 nanometers is the end of the line. Perhaps we should start re-evaluating electron beam projection lithography, electron beam direct lithography, or something else? Okay, on to the next topic. I talk to a lot of people who are working in the silicon photonics space here, and one thing that I keep hearing again and again is that the industry still needs to find the technology's killer app to build up volume and stimulate more research in the ecosystem. Kind of like how the emergence of mobile smartphones and their need for skinnier SoC packages stimulated investment in what we now call chip-scale packaging technologies. People seem to think that there might be something in the interconnect space, and indeed, light is a less lossy and more power-efficient way of delivering communication signals, and there is industry precedence in light replacing copper, but again, nothing so far. Either the R&D or demand isn't there yet. Perhaps TSMC's recent continued investments in their photonic engine technology, COOP, might crack the nut? We shall see. News came out during the show about some money, like $2 to $3 billion, allocated by the EU CHIPS Act to various research labs for advanced semiconductor development. IMEC, of course, will receive some of that money. The EU CHIPS Act has not received the same amount of attention that the US CHIPS Act or the major policy initiatives in Korea, Japan, and China have. And there have been a mix of reactions from the people I talked to about it. More than a few are skeptical. For instance, there is a broad recognition that Europe does not host many of the major demand drivers, like mobile phones or data centers, other than automotive, of course. On the other hand, there are a few people who realize that, but nevertheless insist that we should still build advanced semiconductor fabs in Europe for national security reasons. Europe is already spending a lot of money on things, why not semiconductors too? Deciding whether or not Europe should spend billions of dollars of taxpayer money on semiconductor manufacturing is beyond my pay grade, but the division of opinions is fascinating. I want to thank IMEC and my helper Jade for the opportunity to attend the show. They were great hosts during my visit the next day as well. I also want to thank the various people I was able to meet while I was there. I felt like I was constantly meeting new people, and though I wanted to have deeper conversations with all of them, we all too quickly had to move on, and I apologize for the brusqueness. A few people hag on Europe for a seeming lack of semiconductor progress, but from my perspective, Europe is doing very well on the technology and research side. I got to see a whole lot of really smart people work on really far out there tech. Much of this stuff will never see the light of day, but that is why we have nonprofits, universities, and grad students working on that stuff and not expensive R&D personnel. Part of learning what works is learning what does not. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.